مُنْعَامُ وَالصَّلَاةُ وَالسَّلَامُ عَلَى مُحَمَّدٍ سَيِّدِ الْأَنَامِ وَعَلَى آلِهِ الْكِرَامِ وَصَحْبِهِ الْعِظَامِ وَسَلَّمَ تَسْلِيمًا كَثِيرًا مَا دَامَ يَجْرِي هَذَا النِّظَامِ وبعد قال تبارك وتعالى ألم تكن أرض الله واسعة فتهاجروا فيها. Respected brothers, elders, mothers, sisters and youngsters, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi ta'ala wa barakatuh. We begin by praising Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, acknowledging His greatness and His oneness, and we send the best of salutations upon the final messenger, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, peace and blessings upon him. We have entered one of the sacred months, and that is the month of Rajab. And according to a sound narration, one of the du'as and famous supplications that the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would often articulate and recite is Allahumma barik lana fi Rajab wa Sha'ban wa ballighna Ramadan. That O Almighty, bless us in this month of Rajab and also the next month of Sha'ban. And O Almighty, allow us to live to see Ramadan. Let us all live to see Ramadan. So we make dua that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us those blessings and those bounties in these sacred months. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allow us to experience the month of Ramadan. In fact, the ulama say Rajab is the springboard for Ramadan, meaning that we should have Ramadan in our minds from the month of Rajab. And this begins by fasting on a nafil basis, optional fast, and preparing ourselves, as well as making arrangements so that when we reach the month of Ramadan, we're able to focus and exert ourselves in acquiring the blessings and the bounties of the blessed month of Ramadan. Once again, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless us with these bounties. Now, one of the occurrences in the life of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and that of the Sahaba radiallahu anhum, what we call the seerah and the biography in the month of Rajab, was the migration from Mecca to Habasha, to Abyssinia. And perhaps Ummu Salma radiallahu anha is the best companion who relates what had happened and what had occurred. She says, when life became very difficult for the few Muslims in the city of Mecca, the Prophet Muhammad, peace and blessings upon him's hands were tied. He was unable to protect us. He was unable to take care of us. So therefore, he suggested to the believers in Mecca that those who find it immensely difficult to reside and stay in the city of Mecca, they are permitted to travel and migrate to Abyssinia, to Habasha. And the Prophet Muhammad, peace and blessings upon him, gave a reason and why he selected Habasha specifically. He said, there's a noble king, there's a noble ruler, and this was King Negus, the Najashi. He said, this man is a man of justice, and you will find refuge there, you will find protection there, and you'll be able to live a decent life. So, according to the reports and the narrations, the initial group of companions that migrated were less than 20, including Uthman ibn Affan radiallahu anhu, and also one of the daughters of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And then when they sought refuge there, and they were there for a considerable number of days, then other companions slowly migrated from Mecca to Abyssinia as well. In majority of the books of Sirah and the biography of the Prophet Muhammad, peace and blessings upon him, the number goes up to approximately 100. 100 companions migrated from Mecca to Abyssinia. Now, this was an important episode in the life of both the Prophet Muhammad, peace and blessings upon him, as well as the companions. And when we study the history, when we study the seerah of the Prophet Muhammad, peace and blessings upon him, we definitely come across this major incident or episode in the lives of the companions and the Prophet Muhammad, peace and blessings upon him. Now, the purpose of mentioning this is obviously that this is something that occurred in this month of Rajab in Islamic history. But the more important thing is, no matter which episode or no matter which facet of the life of the Prophet Muhammad, peace and blessings upon him, and the companions we study, we will find reflections and lessons for ourselves to transform ourselves for the better in today's time. We can learn so much from the seerah and the biography for navigation, for guidance, for mentorship in our present and current day life. So when we look at this incident, we find that there are a number of things that occurred which highlight these lessons that I'm referring to. And the first lesson that I want to highlight is that there is nothing objectionable in living as a minority in a non-Muslim community or country. Because many a times we hear this, people who don't have the proper understanding of Islam, they say that it's forbidden to live in a non-Muslim majority country. So as Muslims in Canada, we are a minority. We are a minority. But here, the Prophet Muhammad, peace and blessings upon him, he actually instructed the companions. He said, if you're finding it difficult to stay in Mecca because of the torture and the difficult situations, go to the just ruler under his kingdom in Abyssinia and live as a minority, but you will find protection there, you will find peace there, and your life will be relatively decent. So the ulama, the scholars of Islam, they point out this gives clear proof and understanding that it is absolutely permissible to live as a minority in a non-Muslim community and country. Now, the more important lesson related to this is, why did the Prophet Muhammad, peace and blessings upon him, permit this group of companions to migrate? Because migration is not easy. This was a community, they were now for the first time entering a new land. The climate was different. The people were different. The culture was different. So it's not easy leaving aside one's homeland and then migrating and living in another piece, another area of the land. So the ulama, they describe that the outstanding quality here is protection for one's religion, freedom of religious practice. When that was weighed against the comforts of living in Mecca, so their own community, their own culture, their own type of food, their own experiences that they were used to, they were ready to sacrifice that for a more noble objective. And that objective was to protect the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this is the first lesson for you and I, that no matter what situation, what circumstance we may be in, the objective should always be, how can I protect my religion? How can I protect my values? How can I live and practice my values, the teachings that I learn from the Quran and that of the sunnah of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? We also find another important lesson here. We know the seerah, many of us have studied this episode in the life of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and the Sahaba, is that when the Quraysh saw that the Muslims are migrating to Abyssinia, they made a plan and a plot. And that plan and plot was that we're going to address the ruler, we're going to address King Negus, and we're going to tell him two things. Number one is, these are renegades. These people who are coming from Mecca, they're the scum of our society, and they're fleeing from their misbehavior and misappropriate actions in Mecca, and they're going to spoil your community and your land, so return them to us. This was the first plea or the request they made. The second was that they dishonor your religion, because Najashi was a Christian. He was following the Christian faith. So they said that these are the two points we will address Najashi with, the King Negus with, and thereby we will be able to have the upper hand on these Muslim migrants who left Mecca and now adopted the city or the land of Abyssinia or Habasha. So the lesson I'm highlighting here is look at the justice of King Najashi from different aspects. Firstly, the Prophet ﷺ said, there's a just ruler. He said, there's a just ruler. And the ulama explain that the Prophet ﷺ could have chosen another land under another ruler. The reason why he chose Abyssinia, because he was a man of justice. So this is one highlight of his justice, that the Prophet ﷺ acknowledged his justice even though he was subscribing to another religion. The other highlight of his justice was when the Quraysh did come and they sent Amr ibn al-As, at that time he had not become a believer. When they sent him with gifts. And they sent him with these two messages in a delegation. Najashi didn't take the word of Amr ibn al-As. He could have easily understood and taken the message from the Quraysh because they were known, they had a position, they were people of authority, they had communication amongst themselves. But he said, I want to hear the other side. I want to hear from these migrants that have come. And therefore, the message was given to the believers that gather yourselves and come to the court. And in the presence of those of the Quraysh delegation, the Muslims also were brought forth. So both parties were brought forth in the presence of Najashi, in the presence of King Negus. And he asked both sides. They made their claim that these are renegades, they've left our land, they've caused a problem, they should be returned. And the other is, they say inappropriate things about Christianity. So now Najashi turns to the Muslims. And as we know from the seerah, the Muslims had come to an understanding that Ja'far ibn Abi Talib radiallahu anh is very articulate. His communication skills are very well known. He should represent our perspective. So while they were discussing, the Muslims were discussing, they said, look, what if we are told to leave? And what if we're sent back? So the companions, they said amongst themselves, we'll say the truth. مَعَلَّمَنَا رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَمُ Whatever the Prophet has taught us, we will declare it. And Ja'far is the most appropriate to articulate our version. So Najashi addresses Ja'far radiallahu anhu. It's a very famous speech. Ja'far radiallahu anhu, he explained the position. He said, we were a community that were drowning in ignorance. And we were eating dead animals. We were fighting amongst ourselves. We did not honor our own family members and our own community. We disregarded the poor. The wealthy would take advantage of the poor. So on and so forth. Until finally Allah sent to us Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And we reformed ourselves. We recognized each other's rights. We understood what our responsibility is with one another. And instead of worshipping stones, we now worship the Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So he was impressed. He asked a number of questions. In fact, it's very detailed, and I would definitely advise you to study and read upon the whole incident. But one of the questions Najashi asked Ja'far radiallahu anhu is, هَلْ مَعَكَ Do you have with you مَا نَزَّلَ اللَّهُ What Allah has revealed عَلَى Muhammad, to Muhammad that you're referring to sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And Ja'far radiallahu anhu said, yes. And he recited the verses of Surah Maryam. And as we know, the surah, the chapter Surah Maryam, it refers to Jesus, Isa alayhi salatu wasalam. It refers to the mother of Jesus, Maryam alayhi salatu wasalam. It refers to the whole lineage of Isa. And it honors both Maryam and Isa alayhi salatu wasalam. So he also asked the question, these people are saying you dishonor and you disrespect. They said, no, Jesus is part of our faith. Yes, we do not regard him as the Son of God, but we do regard him as a prophet and a very noble, great personality. It's mentioned in some of the reports that upon hearing the verses, Najashi began to weep. And he made a remark. He said, هَذَا مِن مِشْكَاتٍ وَاحِدَةٍ. He said, what is revealed to Jesus and what is revealed to this person you're saying, Muhammad, it's from the same fountain. It's from the same fountain. It's not something new. So upon the conclusion, what happened was, is the King Najashi, he allowed the Muslims to remain in his land. He said, you are free to stay here. And he refused to accept the gifts the Quraysh had brought. And he had understood that these people had come with a plan and a plot to remove the migrants with no justified cause. So again, this highlights the justice of this king. This highlights the justice of King Najashi, the ruler, and the Prophet ﷺ had acknowledged this. So again, the lesson for you and I is that when we live up to justice, then it is a character, it is a noble characteristic that will take us very far. In fact, many of the ulama say that he had embraced Islam later on. Najashi had embraced Islam later on. And what's the evidence to this? The evidence is that when the Prophet ﷺ heard of his death in Medina, he did Salatul Janaza ala al-Ghaib. He did funeral prayer in Abyssinia. He could not travel to Najashi's funeral, but where he was in Medina, he performed the funeral prayer in Abyssinia. So this proves that he had embraced Islam. So therefore, the ulama say, what was the cause for him to be bestowed with Islam is that he was a man of justice. So when we develop good characters, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala blesses us. And one of the greatest of characteristics that we all need to have is justice. And justice begins with ourselves, with our family members, with our community, and to the highest levels. When we see justice, there is peace. When there's the lack of justice, then we'll see chaos and we'll see challenging circumstances and situations. So this is another reflection I wanted to highlight. And then one final reflection I would like to emphasize here is that despite Ja'far radiallahu anhu and the Muslims being in a difficult position, they were being interrogated by the head of state. They were being interrogated by the head of state. One is our friends interrogate us, or a stranger interrogated. This is interrogation from the head of state. The other challenging situation is the Quraysh, who were already close with Najashi, they had come with some false claims. So it was a very challenging circumstance. And there was a protocol in the court of Najashi. This is mentioned in the reports and the narrations. The protocol was anyone who comes in the court of Najashi, they would have to bow down. They would have to bow down, perhaps out of respect, perhaps out of that protocol of worship. So the representatives of the Quraysh, they adhered to the protocol and they bowed down. When the Muslim representatives, including Ja'far radiallahu anhu, when he came and he saw this protocol, he respectfully declined, but he explained his position. He said, you and I worship the Almighty, and we only bow down to the Almighty, but I still honor you and I respect you as the ruler, as the head of state. So he understood and he didn't mind that violation of that protocol because it was explained. So there's a couple of points we can learn from here. Number one is never let go of your values. It's very easy, especially in a difficult circumstance, to let go of our values. We're in a rush. It's something we have to get done. There's nothing halal available. We say, okay, we'll just say Bismillah and eat the haram. No, don't let go of the values. Take out time to find the halal and consume the halal. You have a busy schedule. You think there's no time to pray. You get busy and then you want to discard the prayer. Never let go of the values. Ja'far radiallahu anhu was in the circumstance of challenge from every corner. But he stood firm on his values. He said, I'm not going to prostrate. I'm not going to bow before anyone other than the Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this is a very important message or reflection that we learn from this incident. And there's many more that we can learn. I just want to conclude with one specific aspect. After a number of years, as we know, the Prophet ﷺ migrated from Mecca to Medina. This news came to some of the companions who had migrated to Abyssinia. So what they did is they left Abyssinia because now they understood there's a land that belongs to the Muslims. So they respectfully took permission from the ruler, from King Najashi, and they migrated to Madinatul Munawwara. Now, in Madinatul Munawwara, there is an incident, and some of the reports say this was with Umar radiallahu an and a woman. The woman's name was Asma bint Umais radiallahu ta'ala anha. So what was this incident? There was a discussion going on, and Umar radiallahu anhu said, "We are more honorable because we came to Medina before you did. We came to Medina before you did. We migrated to Medina with the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. You went to Abyssinia, and then from Abyssinia you only came now after a number of years after the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam's migration." So Umar radiallahu anhu and the people that were with him, they said, "We have a very noble and high position based on this quality of migrating with the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam." Asma bint Umais, she objected. And she said, "No, you had it easy because the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was with you. So if you had any question about the religion, you could directly go to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. If you didn't have something to eat, if you didn't have shelter, you went to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam made the arrangements. We were in an unknown land, and we didn't have the Prophet with us. We had challenging circumstances. We were in a minority where everyone were Christians and we were Muslims." So she found it offensive. She said, "I'm not going to eat, I'm not going to drink until I take this matter to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam." She took the matter to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam called Umar radiallahu anhu and those who were with him, and he asked from both of them that what was said, and whatever had transpired was explained. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "All my companions are noble. There's no distinction between one companion over the other." But then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "I'll tell you one thing, Umar. You only migrated once, but Asma bint Umais and those who were with her, they migrated twice. So they get the reward of two migrations, a migration to Abyssinia and a migration to Medina." So indeed, what we learn from these life stories of the Sahaba and the Prophet Muhammad ﷺ is that priority in their lives was the religion. It was their values. And if we stay firm on our values, no matter the circumstance, no matter the challenging situation, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's mercy, His blessings will definitely be with us. We make dua that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala empower us and give us the ability to be firm on our religion. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allow us to learn from the seerah and the biography of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us amongst those who succeed in this world and the hereafter. Wa akhiru da'wana anil hamdulillahi rabbil alameen.